What is up? Good mic work back at you yet again. Doing a lot of videos lately. This is your Monday Night Raw review for August 3rd, 2015. So unfortunately, a couple of days ago, we've all heard by now the unfortunate passing of Rowdy Roddy Piper. Lots of support from the wrestling community. Everybody has been sounding off about how much they loved Roddy Piper and how much he meant to them and their lives and a lot of their careers. WWE had a really nice tribute to Roddy Piper tonight, which I'll get into in a minute. Even Ronda Rousey dedicated her fight on Saturday in the UFC to Roddy Piper, who allowed her to use the nickname Rowdy. She beat the fucking shit out of that girl in like 30 seconds. I am full-blown in love with Ronda Rousey. She is awesome. I really like that she even shouted him out in the post-match interview as well. I thought that was really cool and really classy, and she definitely earned the heart of this wrestling fan by doing that. Speaking of the UFC, I will briefly touch on Dana White. He did make a few waves a couple of days ago on Twitter, and I was kind of laughing. I was one of the ones giving him shit for it as well, but, you know, really in the back of my mind, I wasn't really offended by what he said. All he was doing was, he was responding to some fan that was actually giving him shit, and then he just took a little shot and saying WWE is fake. And of course, to a wrestling fan, they freak out. And I understand that the term is disrespectful, especially to a lot of wrestlers that bust their ass and get hurt every day. They do not like to hear their profession being called fake when they work just as hard as anybody else in any line of athletics do. As a matter of fact, they probably work more. So they take it as an insult, and I do understand that. But at the same time, you know, a guy like Dana White, when people say wrestling is fake, they're using it in a more general term. You know, I kind of laugh at how wrestling fans get so offended about the word fake. It kind of reminds me of, you know, the phrase, I'm not fat, I'm big boned, you know, it's the same thing. I think even people that call wrestling fake, they know those guys can get hurt. They do see wrestling and they understand that it does take a little bit of athleticism to go out there and do what they do. And it does hurt and they do hurt each other for real. The storylines and the outcomes are just scripted and wrestling fans prefer it if people just refer to wrestling as scripted and not fake. But people who refer to wrestling as fake or want to say it's an insult or something like that, deep down they know what the deal is. They're just using fake in a general sense. And on top of that, you know, it's not like, I mean, the cat's been out of the bag for a long time. Vince McMahon let everybody know this shit was quote unquote fake about 30 years ago. So the fact that Dana White just sounded off on some kid, I was really surprised at the heat he got for that. I mean, I was one of the ones giving him shit, so I'm just as guilty. I just thought it was a fun opportunity to make a few jokes about what he said. But really, when you look at it, you look at the bare bones of it, all he was doing was mouthing off to some jack-off fan that was giving him a hard time on Twitter, and he just said something that he didn't realize was going to raise the ire of the wrestling community and a few wrestlers as well, and a lot of people jumped down his throat for it. So, you know, to me, it wasn't the end of the world. I don't dislike Dana White. I mean, the WWE and the UFC, you know, they're maintaining, they're coexisting. I mean, WWE, of course, has had the use of Ronda Rousey recently at WrestleMania 31, possibly even next year. WWE showed some footage from her UFC fight tonight on Raw, where she dedicated the match to Rowdy Piper and all of that. So, you know that Vince and Dana White, I'm, you know, they get along to an extent okay. I'd hate to see, you know, these two companies start feuding with each other and there become bad blood, because I think it's in both of their interests to remain on relatively good terms, especially when you have crossover stars like Brock Lesnar and CM Punk and now hopefully Ronda Rousey, if she actually does come in and do some sort of a match with the WWE in the future. I know some hardcore UFC fans probably wouldn't want to see that. I'm not a big UFC or Ultimate Fighting fan. I don't watch too much of it. I do like it when I do see it, but I'm not a hardcore fan, and I know their fan base can be just as crazy and just as hardcore as wrestling fans can be, and they will be just as quick to defend the sport that they love. I'm not saying anything negative about the UFC or any sort of mixed martial arts at all. I have no problem with the sport or anything about it at all. I just personally don't watch it, and I'm not that into it. But it is still a cousin of professional wrestling. They're not direct competitors because, you know, WWE is entertainment. But, you know, you can at least call them cousins or stepbrothers or something like that. They are in the same realm of entertainment, or the same realm of a fan base anyway, as far as what they target. So it's always interesting when the two companies mix. But as far as what Dana White said about pro wrestling, I'm really not offended by it at all. WWE admits that their shit is entertainment and it's scripted virtually every day. Right now, as I speak, Paige is on the Stone Cold Steve Austin podcast on the WWE Network talking about how her matches are scripted and staged. So to me, somebody using the word fake in a general sense is not the end of the world, and I think we should all lighten up, give the guy a break. Moving on to Monday Night Raw, you know, tonight's show was not half bad. It had its moments. The show opens up with a very touching tribute to Rowdy Roddy Piper, which we knew they would do. Everybody, the whole roster, and Vince and Stephanie, Triple H, everybody came out on the ramp at the beginning of the show, and they did the 10-bell salute. A few of the fans were assholes near the end. They were hooting and hollering a little bit. That always happens, you know, in any sort of moment of silence. Not everybody is going to completely shut the fuck up, but this seemed a little worse than normal, and there was just a few too many of them making noise for me, and if I would have been there, I would have hit a few of them in the face with a baseball bat. They followed that up with a really nice video package tribute to Roddy Piper, you know, showing a lot of the highlights from his career. I joked on Twitter the other day that I was like, wow, it's a pretty daunting task for the WWE's production crew to have to put together a video package spanning Roddy Piper's career and exclude Hogan from it. How the hell do you do that? And they did a pretty good job of it. You know, Hogan made an appearance once or twice, I think, in the video package. But all in all, it was a really nice tribute. And even without all of his history with Hogan, they still showed, you know, really a good portion of what his career was all about. So I enjoyed the little 3-minute piece. It was nice. All in all, the wrestling world, we lost a big one. We lost a fucking icon. Once we return from commercial after the Piper tribute, we open up with a Seth Rollins promo. He comes out to the ring, and of course, the WWE is playing up him breaking John Cena's nose a lot. Seth Rollins, of course, is bragging about it. Forget about him tapping out last week. That never happened. I don't even think he brought it up. He's out there gloating like he beat Cena right in the middle of the ring, which I loved. Very good promo, actually, by Seth Rollins tonight. And what was also really cool and interesting is that he laid down the challenge to John Cena at SummerSlam, and get this, title for title. Now, that really changes my line of thinking once that was announced, because if they're going to go title for title, that throws a few other options out there. And keep in mind, what I'm about to discuss here is not, I cannot stress this enough, because I said something on Twitter and somebody mistook that for me wanting that to happen. Oh, you can't tell me that's not going to be a good idea or whatever the fuck. I'm just saying, in putting myself in WWE shoes and the way they think, these are some of the things I think they could do in the WWE title match now that it's title for title. First of all, I don't really see the point of putting the United States title on Seth Rollins, but at the same time, I also don't see the point in putting the WWE title on John Cena. So now that it's title for title, what the fuck do they do here? You guys can help me out trying to figure out ways to book this match. I've been saying all along, especially after Seth Rollins tapped out last week and lost to John Cena clean right in the middle of the ring, that Seth Rollins needs to escape this pay-per-view with the WWE title and preferably even defeat John Cena. But now it's not so easy to say that. I know if I ask all of you, hey, who do you think should win? Oh, Seth Rollins should beat John Cena in the middle of the ring clean. Of course he should. But let's just take a look at what that means. That means Seth Rollins would be the United States champion. I really don't want Seth Rollins to be the one to knock off John Cena. I would love for that to be saved for somebody else. And nothing against Seth Rollins. It's just that he's already WWE champion. And if you're going to put an end to John Cena's long U.S. title reign, I think it needs to be, I don't know, just somebody else, because Seth Rollins doesn't need to hold two belts. Anytime that's happened in the past, one of the belts needs to be vacated. So what's Seth going to do? Just win it and then vacate the title and they have a tournament for it? That's the way you want to end this historic U.S. title run by John Cena? That's the way it comes to an end? No fucking way. So in my mind, there's almost no way to get out of this match without factoring Sheamus and a Money in the Bank cash-in. Now, to me, the only way that Seth Rollins winning the United States title would make any sense at all is if they wanted to give Seth Rollins something to do if he was going to be losing the WWE title. So what I was thinking is that maybe Seth Rollins defeats John Cena, wins the U.S. title, and then Sheamus comes out and cashes in the Money in the Bank and beats Seth Rollins for the WWE title. That means Sheamus can have his little run, and Seth Rollins now is given the United States title, a belt that means a lot more than it did previously, and that'll give him something solid to do while Sheamus has his little run. I would love to see Seth Rollins be a 2-time WWE champion by year's end. I would love to see Seth, if he is to lose the belt at SummerSlam, maybe regain the belt at something like Survivor Series, a pay-per-view that they haven't done jack shit with in recent years. We could use a big memorable show here, and I think Seth Rollins winning back the WWE title on that show would be wonderful. I'm just trying to figure out a way to give Sheamus the fucking belt. If the WWE is going to insist on putting the WWE title on him, I feel the sooner the better. That way they can take it off of him way before the year's end. And like I've said many times, I do not want to see Sheamus going into WrestleMania 32 as the WWE champion. There's also the possibility that Sheamus could do what Seth Rollins did at WrestleMania 31, and instead of waiting for there to be a winner, comes out before the match is over and inserts himself in the match and makes it a triple threat. Now, if that happens, I'm guessing that still will only leave Seth Rollins' title on the line. John Cena will be able to keep his U.S. title if Sheamus is able to come in there and steal one. And then they get out of that deal, and John Cena still has the U.S. title. It just means that Seth Rollins has dropped it to Sheamus, and maybe the two of them can feud throughout the fall. Although, in WWE's line of thinking, and that's another side of the coin, is that I'm thinking to myself, they might want or prefer Sheamus to cash in against a babyface. I'm not saying it has to be that way. I have no problem if Sheamus cashes in on Rollins. I don't give a fuck. I'm just saying in WWE's eyes, they might feel like it will make more of an impact if the evil, dirty heel Sheamus cashes in against a babyface. And that's where some of my other ideas come into play, and I know nobody's gonna like to hear this, but just hear me fucking out and don't rip my nuts off. I'm just saying this could happen, so don't think that I want it to happen. I've also been thinking a lot about John Cena approaching Ric Flair's title record. Now, if I'm not mistaken, one more title win ties him with Ric Flair. The one after that, he will break the record. Now, I know, really, Ric Flair won more than 16 titles? I know that. All I'm saying is professional wrestling, WWE, acknowledges 16. So you gotta think that maybe they want to make a big deal about when and if John Cena does tie and break this record, because he most likely will. So if they want to give John Cena like a quick run, like a cup of coffee, just to give him that one more run that ties him with Ric Flair, they could have him beat Seth Rollins, and then Sheamus can come in and cash in on John Cena, take the title away from him. They can either do that at SummerSlam or the next night on Raw or whatever. John Cena can have his rematch. Maybe they can throw the three of them in a triple threat at Night of Champions, and then Cena can come up unsuccessful, continue his U.S. title reign, and then Sheamus and Seth can continue on feuding for the World Heavyweight title. And then when they do decide to give John Cena another world title program, this one will be the one that breaks Ric Flair's record. And I'm thinking it's just something to think about. That's something they could do at WrestleMania 32. I don't know. I hope not. I don't want to see that any more than you guys do. But I'm just saying it's something to think about, so don't hyperventilate. To me, a straight-up winner on either side doesn't make much sense. You're either going to have Seth Rollins holding both belts or John Cena holding both belts, and I don't think that's really feasible right now. Although, if Seth Rollins came out there with two title belts, you can imagine him being a heel and the way he never shuts the fuck up, which is what his shirt says, by the way. I love his new shirt, the play on one of John Cena's old shirts. And if he is able to win two titles, you can imagine he will be the most obnoxious motherfucker in the world the next night on Monday Night Raw. But I'm just thinking to myself, there's no way to get out of this match without tying in Sheamus here. So I wouldn't be too worried about it for those of you out there that are panicking about John Cena. I really don't see a scenario likely where he would win the WWE title and also be the United States champion. There's just no way that's going to happen. Seth Rollins already tapped out to him on Monday Night Raw. WWE isn't just going to end Seth Rollins' reign, not the way they launched him at WrestleMania 31. When he drops that belt, it needs to be in a memorable situation. And that's something else I've mentioned in previous commentaries, is that I thought whenever Seth Rollins' reign would end, it should be the main event of a pay-per-view. Now, I know with SummerSlam, no matter what you do on that show, whether you're the main event or not, it's going to be remembered. So I'm not saying it's out of the question for there to be a title change in a title match that's not the main event. I just think, and I would prefer it, and I think the WWE might also prefer it, if something like that took place to close out a show, or it was the last thing you saw before the pay-per-view went off the air. And plus, don't forget, Taker and Brock has got to follow this. So the WWE doesn't want to go too crazy with a really crazy finish that makes the whole world explode, because that's going to really hinder Brock Lesnar and Undertaker to go out there and be able to follow something that exciting. But to me, it seems like Sheamus coming out of SummerSlam as the WWE champion might be the most likely option here. And I wouldn't mind seeing that, just because it keeps the title off of John Cena and it keeps either guy from holding two belts, because that's going to be a difficult situation to get out of. So maybe maybe they just got to give Sheamus the WWE title. I don't dislike or hate Sheamus. He's just not a guy that I really want to see on top. He's not one of my favorites. I don't consider him a big draw. I like things about him. I think he's a big, tough dude who can have good matches and turn it on when he wants to. I love him as a heel a lot better than I did a babyface. I think he has a great entrance and a lot of other things about him that I do like. It's just Sheamus is not the guy. I don't put him up there with Brock. I think if WWE wants a heel WWE champion, they've got a good one right now in Seth Rollins, and they should just keep rolling with him. But now that it's title for title, we're going to have to see something go down here. So we'll see. At least at the end of the day, I'm excited that we don't have a predictable match here. There's all sorts of different factors. Could go a lot of different ways. So that's a good thing, in my opinion, whether you agree with John Cena having this title opportunity or not. I don't care. To me, I just want the match to be good, and I want the story to be good. Hopefully it will be. John Cena, I don't know how long he's going to be out still. He's in some bad shape. He had surgery on his nose, and his face is a mess. I'm guessing he'll be good to go by the time SummerSlam rolls around. It's a good thing. It's a good thing this same injury didn't happen a week before the pay-per-view. Could you imagine? That would suck. But time will tell on the WWE title match. Maybe as weeks go on here and we get closer to SummerSlam, we can maybe smell a little bit of what they're going to do. And I guess we just have to wait and see. After Rollins announced that he wanted to have a title for title match with Cena at SummerSlam, he decided he's going to have a WWE title open challenge on Monday Night Raw. Since Cena is on the shelf, he can't do his own open challenge, so Seth is going to come out there and fearlessly challenge anybody to take the WWE title off of him. And Neville comes out. Now, to me, this is great. Neville's not going to win the WWE title, and he's going to go out there and have an awesome match with Seth Rollins. So I was 100% on board with this. The match was good, and I'll tell you, man, Neville kind of won the WWE title. He kind of won the WWE title twice. First time, Seth Rollins was really late kicking out, and I think that referee kind of pulled his hand up there a little bit. The announcers called him out for it, and were making it seem like, oh man, the referee screwed up. And then they go to a few spots later where Neville hits his finisher on Rollins and pins him again. This time, Seth Rollins' foot is on the ropes because Neville is, I think, hooking his leg so far back that it bends completely over and is touching the second rope. Referee realizes his mistake and waves off the three count. The match continues, and then Seth Rollins is able to counter, I believe, another attempt at the Red Arrow and nail Neville with a sweet pedigree. Great sell job by Neville on that pedigree. Went completely upside down. Very scary for a second. I thought he was going to land right on the top of his head. But Neville was awesome. Took that thing like a boss. And Seth gets the three count and gets the win. Retains the WWE title, which we assumed he would. Although the WWE did make that match very interesting. And it was awesome. Very competitive. We had Brock Lesnar on the show tonight, too. And I was interested to see that because I didn't really think we would see Undertaker, so I was thinking to myself, what are they going to do other than cut a promo? And that's all they did. But much to my delight, the promo was even more awesome than normal by Paul Heyman. He fucking killed it tonight. So he came out there, talked for a little bit, introduced Brock Lesnar, who came out to the ring, through the stairs in the ring, stood on top of the stairs. It reminded me of when Kurt Angle had his gold medal ceremony and the confetti was coming down, or whatever he did, maybe when he won the WWE title, I don't remember. He probably had a couple of those things, but it kind of reminded me of when he would do that. And Brock is standing up there on the stairs, all badass. Paul Heyman is just going off on the mic. And I want to talk about this match as well. I've been thinking a lot about it, and a lot of people are not too happy with it. I mean, we all love Undertaker and everything, but I think a lot of people are a little bit against the match taking place. But I'm actually warming up to it a little bit. I mean, when Paul Heyman cuts a promo like that, how can you not get jacked for a match? I mean, this thing should be pretty epic, hopefully. Now, a lot of people are very worried because they're thinking to themselves, what does WWE do here? It seems very obvious that Undertaker is going to win this match. He's never beaten Brock Lesnar before. Plus, he's got to avenge his streak being broken. And it just seems a little bit too obvious to all of us that Undertaker is going to win this match. Now, to me, what I see them doing, or what I would like to see them do, this is SummerSlam. I just can't see them having a straight-up match, slow, methodical match like they had at WrestleMania 30, but with this time, Undertaker tombstoning Brock Lesnar and pinning him to close out the show. As much as the fans love The Undertaker, I don't know if the SummerSlam crowd is going to accept something that simple for the main event. So I'm okay with Undertaker getting a victory here, but I want to see them do something fun. And something even occurred to me. I mentioned when Undertaker first came back that I was like, shit, he kind of seems like a heel. He kicked Brock Lesnar in the balls. He fucked over his WWE title shot, and he just seems like an asshole. People shot that down right away. No way. He's not a fucking heel. He's the Undertaker. What are you talking about? So what if you did something like a double turn in the main event? What if you booked it in a way to where Brock Lesnar, yes, he does lose, but he comes out of it at the end seemingly just as strong as he ever was, and with a lot more respect from the fans? I mean, I think the fans already respect him, but now they are completely on board. So let's just say he gets absolutely decimated. I think an appearance from Kane should be inevitable on this thing, wouldn't you think? I mean, Brock Lesnar destroyed his ankle. You can't have too much interference because the match, I don't think, is a no-holds-barred or anything like that. You guys can correct me if I'm wrong, but this just might be a straight-up match. So they can't go too crazy here with interference and foreign objects because you can just have a DQ then. But if you did it in a way a referee gets knocked out or something like that, or maybe there's a fireball involved, or they do some sort of shit to Brock Lesnar to really fuck him up, you know, but he just won't give up. He won't quit. He's completely destroyed, arm or leg dangling from his body, can barely move. I mean, just severely, severely beaten somehow in his match with The Undertaker to where he simply will not stop. And it literally takes everything that The Undertaker has inside of his soul to finally put away Brock Lesnar and beat him in the end. But after the match, the fans are going to respect Brock Lesnar maybe more than The Undertaker. Because what if The Undertaker wants to come back and have one more run? One more final run leading up to WrestleMania 32. That means, number one, he's gonna need a victory. And who's to say The Undertaker can't be a heel? Don't you think that would be a little fun and a little bit different? What if The Undertaker went back to his roots for his final run in the WWE and became a heel, but maybe finished up his run as a babyface at the very end? What if SummerSlam was the beginning of something like that? Would that be so bad? I'd like to see it, because to me it would be something you wouldn't expect, and it would be fun. And I think The Undertaker would have a fun time doing it, because let's face it, in this stage of his career, he's not going to go out there and have the matches he had with Shawn Michaels a few years back. It was already amazing enough that he did those back then. There's no way he can have a quality of a match like that now. So maybe in order to get his feuds even more over, he's got to use other elements of his personality to bring in the excitement, because the match in the ring might not be very much. So if he's this vicious, dark heel again, who's to say that's so horrible? And it would give Sting a heel opponent to face at WrestleMania if he stayed heel that long. Again, this is a situation where I don't think it needs to be heel and babyface. I think Sting and Taker can easily have a babyface match. But if Undertaker was a heel, it might make it a little bit more, what's the word, fun. As far as what else we saw on Raw, a couple other interesting things. The main event, by the way, was a six-man tag that they were advertising all night. It was Dean Ambrose, Roman Reigns, and Randy Orton taking on Sheamus, Bray Wyatt, and Luke Harper, and of course the team of the unstoppable team of Ambrose, Reigns, and Orton reign supreme. It wasn't that bad of a match. I actually liked it. I liked the finishing sequence. There was a few things about the match that seemed a little clunky, and I was like, yeah, whatever. But the ending was nice, and I thought it was a good enough show and a good enough six-man. I mean, that's just what they do, you know, six-man tags. How many times have we seen these things? This one happened to main event the show. Wasn't horrible. The baby faces closed out the show. Fans seemed happy at the end. Ambrose, Reigns, and Orton were all rocking the Roddy Piper shirts during their pre-match promo, and Ambrose wore it in the match. Thought it was a relatively okay run-of-the-mill six-man tag that we see on Raw all the time. We also had a pretty decent Miz TV segment. I can't believe I'm saying that. I give The Miz a lot of shit, but not today. Miz, that was an awesome tribute to Roddy Piper. Well, I really liked what you said, and I loved what you wore. I never like his outfits. I think he looks like an absolute idiot in everything he wears, but that was beautifully done. I loved his tribute, and, you know, well done tonight, Miz. You actually earned a little bit of my respect. Also, The Miz segment wasn't half bad either with Cesaro and Owens. Now, I like this as well. I like the fact that Cesaro, it seems like they're going to give him another chance. Tyson Kidd being laid up with this neck injury has opened a door for Cesaro. And you know what? I was thinking about it tonight watching Raw. I much prefer Cesaro as a babyface because, you know, when you think about it, his biggest criticism, you know, we heard it from Vince McMahon on the podcast and other people that talk about Cesaro, is that maybe he's not connecting with the fans or he's not a very good promo or whatever. This guy is respected and cheered by the majority of the audience. He doesn't really need it. I mean, there have been very successful people in wrestling that weren't the greatest promo, guys like Chris Benoit. So it's not like it can't be done, and if he's a babyface and the fans want to cheer him anyway, then it's perfect. Then he doesn't need to do a whole lot on the mic. You don't have to worry about him being able to cut the great promo. Yes, he's going to have to be able to talk a little bit, because that's what wrestling is, but it doesn't need to be the number one focus. His number one focus is wrestling. That's what the fans appreciate him for, and I think him in a babyface role, it takes the pressure off of him, because he's already going to get cheered. If you're a heel, you have to really work hard to get the fans to hate you, especially if you're really good in the ring. And Cesaro is not that great of a promo, and putting him in a heel role, you know, fans aren't going to boo him or treat him like the heel the WWE wants, because he can't connect with the fans verbally, you know, the way a heel should be able to do. So I think a babyface Cesaro that just goes out there, keeps his talking to a relative minimum, and does all of his talking in the ring, I think that can make for a really good babyface. And I would love to see Cesaro or Kevin Owens be the guy to knock off John Cena for the U.S. title whenever the hell that day comes. I would love to see it be either guy. I don't give a shit which one, as long as it's one of them. And I hope the WWE doesn't pull back on their push of Cesaro this time. He's going to be feuding with Kevin Owens. Now, here's the thing, you know, with the fans that are always worried about who wins and loses whenever John Cena is involved in a match, what about here? You know, if you ask me, I don't fucking care who wins this feud or who wins these matches between Kevin Owens or Cesaro. I'm going to be happy for either one of their opportunities, no matter who it is. I know the matches are going to be kick-ass, and that's going to be some outstanding work and a lot of fun to watch, and I just can't wait to see it. As far as who wins, I'm not going to pick it apart and worry about the decision of who goes over and all of that. This is two guys that the fans, a lot of us, respect because of how good they are in the ring. The two of them working together in a program, and they're definitely going to have a SummerSlam match. It seems that's pretty obvious at this point, so that's a good thing. I would assume something like that would be your number one contender feud for the U.S. title anyway, so we'll see who comes out on top of that. Should be a lot of fun to watch, and so far, I'm entertained by it. It was a really funny segment tonight, especially when they both kind of told The Miz to shut up at the same time and pushed him away. Those two guys are legit badasses, and they're going to have some great matches. I can't wait to see it. So I'm on board with this feud. It doesn't look like they're treating it like a joke, like Ziggler and Rusev. They're taking it seriously, and I think these guys are going to impress a lot of people. And I'm going to keep my fingers crossed that maybe, just maybe, the WWE will do this Cesaro push right. Speaking of Rusev, he did have a match tonight. They re-chronicled what happened last week with the fish and the dog. And so Rusev had a match tonight against Mark Henry and beat him. So Rusev gets another victory while we wait for Dolph Ziggler to come back. I'm guessing, I don't know the backstage story on this. You guys can fill me in. What's the word on Ziggler? Is he due to come back pretty much any time? I would think he needs to show up on Raw next week or the latest, the week after. In order for them to set something up for SummerSlam, unless they're going to wait and do it after. Otherwise, it seems like that's a match we should see. Some of the other matches we saw the 8-man tag, right? Los Matadores and Lucha Dragons taking on New Day and The Ascension. New Day and The Ascension won that match. Primetime Players were outside doing commentary. New Day looks like they are still Primetime Players' main contenders, and I'm guessing something at SummerSlam will happen, probably a pre-show or a kickoff match. The NXT girls are still kicking ass. Paige made Naomi tap out tonight, and Charlotte and Becky Lynch also got a victory, although it was under suspect circumstances. The referee thought Nikki was tapping out. She wasn't. She was just frustrated and beating her hands on the mat, and the fucking idiot referee screwed up and called for the bell. So Nikki didn't really tap out, and those girls shouldn't got that victory. It was horseshit. But anyway, sometimes mistakes happen on WWE live TV, and you just have to go with it. So they had to pretend like Charlotte and Becky Lynch won the match, when in reality, that wouldn't happen. Nikki would have reversed that thing and beat those bitches clean. There's no doubt in my mind. Also, in an extremely meaningless match, Wade Barrett beat Zack Ryder. So that's all I really have written down for the show, excluding a few backstage interviews here and there aside. We didn't see that much else on the show other than what I talked about. I watched about the first 10 minutes of Paige on Stone Cold's podcast. I really didn't wait to watch the whole thing. I didn't think anything earth-shattering would come out of the interview. What I saw of it so far, it seemed like it was going well. Paige is very funny when she talks. She's very young, and she kind of talks a lot, and she's kind of all over the place or whatever, so she's probably going to confuse old man Austin there a little bit, but I'll go back and check out the rest of what they talked about. I'm sure it's going to be a lot of stuff about Tough Enough, which I did happen to catch a few highlights of that show, and oh man, am I glad I never chose to even come close to watching that. I saw the highlights that I saw by accident when I clicked on the WWE Network, and there they were, and it just looks so awful. I just can't wait till that shit's it's over. I am a little bit curious, though, to listen to a few of her family stories, because we all know where she came from and how wrestling is all over her family like that. So she's had a lot of experience and she's seen a lot in wrestling in her very, very young age. I mean, she's only 23, but she's been around it her whole life. So, you know, she should have a few interesting things to say to Austin, but nothing controversial or nothing juicy or gossipy like all of us wrestling fans like to hear. This is just going to be shit about Tough Enough and Paige's career, I'm sure. So I'll go back and look at that whenever I have time. That is it for me for this week. I've got to get out of here. Most likely, I'll be up here again next Monday night after Raw. However, it is possible I could take next week off. I'm not 100% sure yet. So there is a slight possibility that you might not hear from me until after the Go Home Raw, which basically means that will be my SummerSlam predictions video. Most likely, you'll hear from me before then. But just to play it safe, I want to let you know that there is a possibility that you won't. So you guys have a great week. I'll talk to you soon. Until next time. Peace.